But let's get right to it. Let's bring out our very special guests, starting with the beautiful, the talented, that evil feline temptress herself, Catwoman, Miss Julie Newmar. Next up, the young man who owes his very life to good dental hygiene, Robin the Boy Wonder himself, Mr. Burt Ward. And what can we say about our last guest? Franchise, started this whole crazy thing rolling back in 1966. Show him how much you love him, Mr. Adam West. These three legends we have with us today are about to receive a very special award from Mr. Eddie Ibrahim himself, who runs this whole crazy Comic-Con. Eddie, come on out, won't you? Let's hear it for Eddie.
Hi, so thank you for letting us take a little bit of time on the panel for this. What we're about to present today is the Ink Pot Award to each of our guests here on stage. The Ink Pot Award is an award that is given to people that have helped to promote comics and the popular arts, and I don't think there is any argument that any of these fine candidates deserve an Ink Pot. So at this time, it is my pleasure to give everyone their Ink Pot Award. So thank you very much for all your contributions and everything you've done for pop culture.
Start the questioning with this. Let's start with you, Adam. How does it feel after all this time to finally have the complete remastered episodes available for the fans to see in their own home?
Ralph, let me tell you, the first thing I want to say is you're right. We are delighted that finally Warner's Home Entertainment and we could bring you the complete Batman series in Blu-ray DVD. It's wonderfully done. You've been asking us for years, where is it? Well, here it is, November 11.
Great. And you can pre-order right now, and I would, because I already have mine pre-ordered. Bert,
can I pre-order mine too?
You absolutely can, yes. I'm gonna talk to somebody, see if we can't get you one. How does it feel after all these years, the fans that have asked you time and time again, everywhere you go, when are we going to finally get it at home, and now they have it?
Well, I'm really thrilled because now I have something to watch. You know, fighting crime all the time, you know, it can wear you out, and you've got to have a little entertainment. And I couldn't think of any better entertainment than working with these incredible actors who have influenced so many people in such positive ways, including me.
You were a bad influence.
And Julie, what are your thoughts about finally the home entertainment release of the entire series?
Well, I never thought people would stop asking. And thank you for asking.
Adam, how do you explain the continued popularity of this television program? Decades go by, people love it just as much now as they did when it was first on the air. How do you explain the longevity?
My legs. Well, I'm tell you, because we did it, as we all know, on several levels. And we did it for you guys as kids, with the morality lessons, the ethics, and so on, and all the splash and adventure and color and ba-room and bam and pow and zap. And we did it for you guys as adults, as you grew up, as a comedy, so you would see the satirical elements. And these two were wonderful.
Well, ever since the set was announced, people have been dying to see some footage from the set. We're going to show you some of that. We're also going to show you what the limited edition box set looks like. This thing is a thing of beauty. I think we've got an image to put up there on the big screen so you can see what it looks like. The packaging is incredible. Here's some of the things that you get, these sought-after premiums that will be included in the limited box set. An exclusive Hot Wheels replica Batmobile. The Adam West scrapbook. Now, this is featuring pictures that no one's ever seen before, right? And these are your personal photos?
Well, they're so rare that I haven't even seen them.
Was someone taking them through the blinds at your house? Is that what happened?
Oh, that drone.
There are 44 vintage trading cards inside there, just like the trading cards they had in 1966. Ultraviolet digital copy of all 120 episodes will be available. An episode guide, which has a synopsis of all the episodes, photos from the series, and a personal letter from Adam to all the fans. It is an impressive, impressive box, but what's really impressive, I think, is what's inside the box. The footage is just incredible. Have you guys seen some of the remastered footage that they put together for this set?
Yep, fantastic.
You won't believe it. I mean, those of us who've watched the show for years, I've seen it in syndication and prints that have been shown and shown and shown. And now for the first time, you get to see these episodes the way they were meant to be seen.
It'll knock your socks off.
Let's show you what the difference is between what we're used to watching on television versus what you're going to see in the DVD and Blu-ray box sets. This is a remastered footage. The film's been cleaned, it's been remastered, it's been enhanced digitally for focus and for color. All the scratches from the prints have been removed. This is a crystal clear image that you're going to see your favorite TV show in the way it should be seen. While we're talking about Cesar Romero, who was just so brilliant in that role as the Joker, let's talk about some of our favorite villains from the series. Julie, you got to work with the great Michael Rennie as the Sandman in an episode. What was it like working with him?
Well, I think he was buried under his great big fur coat, as I remember. And it was a very strange episode. But I remember Cesar Romero, and do you know why he had that mustache and they had to cover it up with makeup? Because when he was 23 years old, he had fallen in love with a woman 10 times older than himself, and he wanted to keep that image. And so it's true. He thought it was, he never shaved it off, did he ever?
No.
No, Julie, as a matter of fact, he felt that his entire career was because of his mustache. We knew better. And we allowed him to keep his mustache, and the white makeup would kind of allow his mustache to bristle out of it toward the end of the day. And you saw that, and we thought it was funny, and let's just leave it in. He loved it.
Burt, tell us a few of your favorite villain actors that you worked with on the series.
Well, I was like a kid in a candy store because I was a young actor. This was my first working opportunity. I really consider myself pretty lucky. There was 1,100 young guys that tried out for the role. So for me, everyone working with Julie, working with, Burgess Meredith, the Penguin, or Frank Gorshin, the Riddler. I mean, these are great people, And every one of them, it was a learning experience because you had a chance for me to see how real professionals take their craft very seriously. Even if what they do is funny, they approach it so professionally that you have to respect that and learn something from it.
Well, as a young man, my favorite villain was, of course, Catwoman.
Mine too.
Do you get a lot of men coming up to you saying you were their first crush?
Well, let me put it this way. I had a wonderful experience in Chicago at one of those comic cons, and a man came up to me and he was dragging his son. But his son, about 3 years old, he didn't want to have anything to do with this Catwoman, too scary. Oh my goodness, let me out of here. Worst day of my life, the little kid. And the father said, oh, you understand, in a few years, you And behind the father was standing the grandfather. Very well dressed, very distinguished, and he makes a beeline right straight up to me and he says, Miss Newmar, did you know that you were my first turn on?
Well, let's take another look at some more footage side by side, compared with the old footage with the newly remastered footage available on the Blu-ray and DVD box. It wouldn't be a special box set without some additional bonus features, and this set has plenty. One is Hanging with Batman is the name of one of the features. And it's sort of a slice of life with you, Adam. We've been spending some time with you.
Who?
Adam West, TV's Batman.
I'm amazed at how the clarity of that thing we just saw is fantastic.
And you can see every grain of sand as it comes out.
You know, Catwoman, Julie, you were wonderful as Catwoman. You gave me the curious stirrings of my utility belt. There's also, I think, somebody else here who played Catwoman in our movie, our earlier feature, is Leanne Merriweather here.
Oh, there.
There's a little bonus here.
Is Merriweather here?
I heard that she was somewhere out there.
Here she is, standing up right over there. Merriweather.
Yeah. You see, I may wear glasses, Lee, but I have pretty good eyes. I spotted you out there.
Bring it up.
Yes.
Bring it up. Now it's a fair fight. We've got two heroes and two supervillains. Now it's a fair fight.
Doesn't she look wonderful? I love you, Lee. By the way, she's Miss America. You all know that, don't you?
Yeah. Yeah. Some of the other bonus features on the box set, a segment called Holy Memorabilia Batman, which talks to three Batman memorabilia collectors and looks at all the rare merchandise that came out in the 60s. I mean, Burt, you must remember, in the 60s, it seems like there was countless number of items available with Batman and Robin on them.
Oh, absolutely. And you know, still when we go out and sign autographs and stuff, people have kept those items and they bring them up, the old lunch boxes and trading cards and some dirt.
I just wish you'd take the old lunch out of the box. It's only 40 years old. Come on, Burt.
Well, there's a lot of items, and there's a lot of new items, too. One of the things that really impressed me was the fact that they have these new caricature figures of Batman, Robin, I believe even
thanks to Warner Brothers,
that are so realistic. I mean, you know, you can see the skin texture. I looked at them online, and they actually looked like photographs, but I think they're really spectacular. And, you know, we are thrilled, I can speak for Adam and Julie, to be here to see you all, because you guys are what made our show successful, and I'm kind of happy that we brought some happiness to you guys growing up. Woo!
You know, if nothing else, what we love to do is deliver the laughs and make you guys happy. And that makes us happy. Thank you. Yeah. You've been great fans for many years. And you, Rob.
Thanks.
You've been a fan like no other. And stay away from my hotel room.
I'm sorry. You shouldn't have told me where you were staying. Batmania Born is another segment on the bonus features, which is all about building the world of Batman through art and design. Bats of the Round Table, a candid dinner time conversation with Adam and some celebrity fans are going to be sitting around the table talking about the series. Inventing Batman, in the words of Adam West. I understand, Adam, you've taken your scripts from the first two episodes and you've gone over your original script notes and talked about them, right?
Yes, thank you, Ralph. I have, and that's part of the package. My original script, you know, like the pilot, the first show, and I have a lot of scribbling in it that got me to the character the way I played it. Nobody believed that they wanted me because I wasn't serious enough.
You were in a Nestle ad. That's how the producer found you, right? That's chocolate.
Yes, I mean,
when the show went on the air, it was an immediate hit. You guys knew you had a hit on your hands once it aired. While you were shooting those first two episodes, though, shooting that pilot, did you have any idea this was going to be a special thing that you were working on?
Yeah.
Go ahead, Julie, please.
Well, you said it. You had so much fun doing it. Every single actor that did in these roles said it was the best role of their lives. You just knew it. You felt it. The writing was so brilliant. The ideas, the lighting. There was special lighting for each villain. One would have green lighting. The Joker would have. And then mine was kind of golden, and the whole tilted cameras, and in the color television was just coming into itself in the 60s. And so this was an especially brilliant show, too, and they spent a lot of money on it.
For me, and I think possibly for Adam, you know, we were working like 14 hours a day, and when you film something, you do it in really little pieces. And the way it works is that you have like maybe a minute maximum of what's going to be the action. And you sit there for 45 minutes and wait while they light, and they change this, and that doesn't work, and all of this. And then you finally get up there, and when you work, I mean, it's terrific, and you have to build that energy for that moment that you're up there, but still, until Adam and I actually saw the first episode, we didn't know there were going to be pows and zaps. And when you're in front of the camera with the lights in your eyes, you can't see all that terrific lighting that Julie was describing. So for us, when we actually saw the first episode and we saw all these little pieces that we spent 6 weeks in filming, double takes, triple takes, all of a sudden it came alive. And it's spectacular, and it was spectacular for me, and I think it's because Batman, our series, worked, that it has stayed for generations, for you guys growing up, indeed for your kids and their kids, because it works, and it's very special, and there's a lot of love and heart that all of the performers and the crew put into this show. It's very special.
We knew from the very beginning that we were on to something because 20th Century Fox and ABC and all the others were so excited, and they were really beating the drums, and it was a first of its kind. It was in color, and two shows a week with a cliffhanger, of course, in between. So the excitement on the set, and the excitement when the show broke, Ralph, was incredible. So the only way I could tell that we were onto something besides our daily work and belief in it, I went to a market in Malibu up the road from where I live to get a steak and a six pack. That was the night of the airing of the first show. Well, I was waiting at the checkout stand behind people, and the women kept yelling, "Hurry, hurry, Batman's on tonight, get us out of here." I had a feeling it was all over for me.
It was all just beginning.
There's no more anonymity.
We were talking about some of the bonus features available on the box set of the Blu-ray DVD box set. I want to show you a little piece of one of them. This is called Batmania Born. Again, this is looking about the art behind the fiction. The extras are really going to make Bat fans happy, I think. Here's a couple minutes from Batmania Born. We lost, in my mind, a genius, Lorenzo Semple Jr., who was the original screenwriter for Batman. He wrote that pilot episode and several others and was the story editor, script editor on the show as well, sort of set the tone for the series overall.
He sure did, Ralph. He was the reason I did the show, reading that first script. And, I fell down laughing and I loved it, and I said, I can do something with this, and comedically. And he and I became friends, but he was brilliant with that first script and some of the others.
As a new actor, Burt, you probably weren't prepared for some of the craziness they had you doing on the show when you read those scripts. Lorenzo has such an amazingly inventive mind.
It wasn't the craziness that got me. It was the explosions and the third-degree burns. And, in the very first episode, there's a sequence where we come out of the Batcave in the Batmobile. And I remember I was there early, dressed at 7 a.m. At 7:30, they said, all right, Burt, hop in the Batmobile. We're going to film this sequence coming out of the Batcave, where you come at the camera, make a sharp left turn, and then the sign goes down and you go over it. So I hopped in the Batmobile and I looked over to see Adam, but it wasn't Adam there. It was another gentleman in a Batman outfit. And I said, who are you? And he said, oh, my name is Hubie. And I said, well, why isn't Adam here? He said, well, because I'm a stuntman. This is a very dangerous shot. Adam is over there having a cup of coffee. I said, oh, okay. And then I started to think about it for a minute. I said, well, wait a minute. If this is dangerous, so I called over the second assistant director. I said, Adam's not in the shot. So we know that because it's a dangerous shot. We don't want him to get hurt. I said, yeah, but why am I sitting here? Don't I have a stuntman? He says, yes, you do. Oh, okay, well, where is he? Oh, he's over there having coffee with that. And I said, well, wait a minute, why isn't he here? He says, well, to be honest with you, we can't use him. I said, why? Because he doesn't look like you. I said, well, why did you hire a stuntman that doesn't look like me? He said, we couldn't find anybody else. So anyway, long story short, we come out at 55 miles an hour. The stuntman did his job. He made that sharp left turn. But unfortunately, my door flew open.
Oh, no.
When my door flew open, the centrifugal force threw me to the right. I reached out and just luckily grabbed my little finger around the gear shift knob, which kept me from falling out. The camera crew was actually knocked over, and stuff was all messed up. But I didn't fall out, but my finger was pulled out of joint, and it was like instantly swollen. So when they ran over to us, they said, Burt, we got to get you to the doctor. I said, no, oh my gosh, I said, this is killing me. They said, don't worry, we'll get you to the doctor just as soon as we get this shot. what does that mean? Well, we got to set up, we got to light it, we got to shoot it, it's got to be right. That was at 8 a.m. and at noon, I left to go to the doctor. And it was that same doctor at the emergency hospital that I saw for the next 4 days in a row. And I'd never been to an emergency hospital. From explosions, third degree burns. Do you remember the scene with Frank Gorshin in the car when I was actually playing Molly, who was supposedly dressed like me? And anyway, the car was burning, and I'm down at the bottom. Frank Gorshin is the Riddler is on top, and he jumps out safely, and I get ready to jump out, and then unexpectedly the car blew up. It was not supposed to happen. All I remember was I saw that ground coming at my face really fast. Boom. Second degree burns, the back of the neck. I'm back at the hospital, it's the same doctor. He says, are you accident prone? I said, I don't know, I'm beginning to believe so. But that happened for 5 days. So that's what I remember. And my biggest goal was surviving.
You have any more stories, Bert?
120 of them.
Yes.
What's your most vivid behind-the-scenes memory of filming the series, Adam?
I could never answer that question, Ralph.
Yeah.
No, because I had every day there was a vivid memory, believe me. Now, Bert talked about some of the accident-prone problems. The worst thing on the series was penguin gas. Yes, because in those days they used colored smoke, you know, with kind of an acrid stuff in it. And Burt and I had to breathe it during those scenes. So every day or so, people on other stages would see the ambulance run by and they'd say, "What's that, Ryan?" "Gee, Mia, I don't know." "Oh, it's Burt and Adam again." So I think that smoke was probably the worst stuff, you know.
And Julie, you always seem to work with the musical guest stars on the series. You worked with Chad and Jeremy. You stole their voices.
Yes.
And you also had Leslie Gore as your sidekick, Pussycat.
And right? Paul Revere.
Paul Revere and the Raiders in the Penguin episode. Yeah, a lot of musical guests.
That was a hot show with
You know, there was that scene when Leslie Gore, as Pussycat, introduced herself to me. You remember that?
Sure, yeah.
She said, "Robin, my name is Pussycat, but you can call me Cat."
Still blushes.
And I remember what you called her.
Or you were scratched with cataphrenic, I think it was, that turned you evil. For those who remember that episode, there's been a lot of talk about what we're going to see in the episodes. These are all uncut, complete episodes. So everything from the Batman in color logo that comes up at the beginning of the episode to the end where you see, coming next week, King Tut, all of that will be intact, including Leslie Gore, who sang two songs on that episode. And we never got to see in animation, in the syndication, the second one. They always would cut it out for time. So now we get to see everything from every episode of Batman, the complete team. The show itself has given so much to the overall Batman legend, not just your own legendary TV series, but the character owes so much to the series. For example, you may or may not know that Mr. Freeze, who now, of course, is a legendary Batman villain, never existed before the TV series.
Neither did Aunt Harriet. And you know why they invented Aunt Harriet? Oh. Tell the story.
What do you mean, Julie?
Come on, tell the story. Why did they invent Aunt Harriet?
Well, because we're a couple of guys running around in tights. Living
That's
together
true.
In Wayne Manor.
Yeah. That's true.
There were certain people who thought that was a little suspect in some ways. But I'll tell you, there have been some really macho guys who wore tights. Look at Errol Flynn, for Pete's sakes. Look at Daffy Duck. I don't know. They added Aunt Harriet to assuage or assuage the fears of many people that Burt and I were. Silly, so Aunt Harriet just kept her eye on us and baked us cookies.
And more milk.
Yes.
Here's a clip from Mr. Freeze himself. I think this is of the late, great George Sanders, who first originally played Mr. Freeze.
Oh, he was wonderful.
He was terrific in that role.
Yeah.
Here's just another example of how crisp and clear and amazing.
One of the final dinners with George Sanders, you know, on the show.
I thought that was Otto Preminger. Was that George Sanders being on?
Well, he did. There's another story there, Julie, but...
There were three Mr. Freeze, you know.
But when George Sanders looked down the table, because we were sitting in the green, or he was in the greenish cold part, and we were in a little warmer part, he said to us, he said, "Baked Alaska, Batman."
Of course, the great Eli Wallach, also Mr. Freeze in the show, who just passed recently. I think it's time to open up the questions to the audience. I'm sure these people have a lot of things they want to ask you guys. They've been waiting a long time to talk about this thing. So please, let's open it up to the audience. Hi there. What's your question?
Hi. First of all, I'm trying to say, Adam West, your voice is magical.
I like to sing something.
Yeah.
Come on, Carlos.
Oh, okay. So this is for you, Adam West and Burt Ward. If you could go back and play any character you wanted, would you switch or stay who you are? And if you would switch, who would you pick and why?
is there anyone on the show, any character on the show that you would have liked to have played if you could go back in time?
Well, I wanted to be Robin.
a little tall for Robin.
No, I love playing the part. I think, honestly, in my opinion, there's been many Batmans, but in my opinion, there really only is one Batman, and that's...
Yeah!
Our show was a comedy for the adults, and we played it with comedy timing and thinking funny, and yet for the kids it was very serious. So we played that level as well. Now our show was somewhat bizarre, but it was never grotesque. There's somebody else out there.
Hi there, what's your question?
Hello. I just wanted to say, that's loud. thank you so much for the years of entertainment. I grew up watching the show, and I realized that the reason I leaned into this world so much is that you were the world that took over as my parents' marriage broke up. So thank you for that. And I would like to ask, is there some sort of secrets that you would like us to know now that we could know in the 60s about the show?
Secrets? Any secrets about the show that you can finally reveal now that we've got it on home entertainment?
Secrets? Yeah. I don't know if I should. What do you think?
Yeah.
Too many.
Well, it's about Burt.
Nah. You guys must have people coming up all the time over the past 4 decades telling you how much of an influence that you had on their lives, either personally or professionally or both. I'm sure you all have had those moments, right?
Well, we're the luckiest actors in the world. That's the way I reason it, and I'm sure they do too. Because we've done many other movies. I've done 5 TV series, and Family Guy's been wonderful for me. The most expensive show ever produced at the time, and it was done with such delicacy and care that I'm just really pleased to have been part of it in my own small way. Thank you.
Adam, you've told me in the past that you run into judges and attorneys and cops and firefighters who say that they got into law enforcement, they wanted to be the good guys because of what you and Burt showed them each and every week.
Well, I have a little token of esteem from your police chief that I got this evening, presented by her.
Was that a get out of jail free card?
Who knows what goes on in my life. But, you know, to hear stories like that, that we do what we do because of Batman, is incredible.
Hi there. What's your question?
Well, I will tell you that the biggest scare of my parents' life was because of Batman. I was 6 years old when the show originally aired, and since it was in color, and my neighbors had one of those new color televisions, I just walked outside and went down the block at 6 years old to watch it in color. Yeah. My question is, with all the reboots in this era of reboots, why have none of you made a cameo appearance in any of the movies?
Yeah.
Well, in my case, I haven't been asked. But it's okay. It's okay. I'm a billionaire, and it's okay.
You've seen Stately West Manor. It's very impressive. Yes. Hi there. What's your question?
Hey. Well, hey. I was a little nervous here. My dad does says hi to you guys. He's a big fan, and I'm a big fan, too. Before my question, I do have to say this one thing. I played the Batman Arkham games. And last year's Batman Arkham Origins comes with all these costumes you can wear. And you can play like Batman's first appearance to the recent costume, but nothing brings me great joy than being Adam West Batman roaming the streets and taking down thugs. My dad walked in and while playing that game, he goes, is that the Adam West Batman? And I'm like, yep, I'm fighting crime as Adam West. So, the one question I had for all three of you, if Batman would have continued from three of you, what episode would you like to have seen done? Any ideas you would have done? Especially crossover, since you did have Green Hornet and Kato as the first superhero team-up.
There's a great comic book out, by the way, which teams up Batman and Green Hornet and Kato. I suggest you pick it up.
I like the first episode.
Yeah, that sort of set the tone for everything, didn't it?
Yeah.
I think if he continued to make the show, we would have developed newer, more modern things. You know, when Batman first came out, we were really, our show was ahead of its time. I mean, it really was. And, you know, because we stopped making them, they're classics, but had we continued, I think we would have found innovative ways to continue to entertain you, and bigger and, you know, more dangerous villains and situations more like what we have in today's program, but Adam, still family-oriented.
Adam, wasn't there talk at one time of another network picking up the series and doing a fourth season?
That's right, but they had already destroyed the Batcave and some of the other standing sets.
It's because you took all the parts, Adam, so you could sell them later.
You want to buy a cake? Yes. They figured it would be too costly. Batman was the most expensive show ever shot at the time. And, you know, the first show on twice a week in color. So there you go. You know, it was unique.
And the studio can make just as much money when it goes into syndication.
Yeah. 120 episodes, they want their money back.
Hi there, what's your question?
Well, first off, it's a real honor to meet you all. And since you brought it up, how much is the cape? One thing I remember about Batman is he always had something handy on his belt. Like, for instance, he had the shark repellent when he got attacked by a shark. I was just curious if there was any other utility or gadget on his belt that was thought of to maybe be used in an episode but just never made it.
That's a good question. I can't answer that.
Thank you.
I always enjoyed when you pulled the massive, enormous, Lucite bat shield out of some little pocket in your belt. That was always my favorite moment with the utility belt.
Well, that was kind of my favorite prop, too. The fact that, you know, we timed it so that it looked like this big thing was, I'm pulling it out of the utility belt, what it's going to say. You know, there's only one cliffhanger, now that we bring that up, that was different on the show. Does anyone know what that was? Only one. The other cliffhangers we got out of with some clever ruse or whatever the writers cooked up. But this one cliffhanger was when we were swallowed by the giant clam. They couldn't think of a way to get us out. So they finally resorted to the fact that Batman was so strong, he opened the clam and we got out.
I just remember poor Burt's foot dangling out of that clam, bouncing around.
Yes. I still love clam chowder.
Hi, what's your question?
Hi, question for Adam West in particular. You created a Batman in this comedy show who was duly deputized, who wouldn't chase after a villain until Robin put his seatbelt on. What's it been like watching Batman in the newer versions where you get more of a vigilante or you get more of this gritter reality? What's the sort of the difference between how you created the character versus the newer versions?
I have no idea, because they're doing their thing and we did ours. It's that simple.
And you did it very well.
Good answer.
Hi, what's your question?
Hi, so it's really exciting meeting you. The first bonding experience I ever had with my dad was watching this, so you've been in our house forever. I've read your autobiography, Into the Batcave, and I loved your comment in the first episode where you ad-libbed, "What a way to go-go," when the go-go dancer fell down into her doom. And I was wondering, is there any other lines you remember ad-libbing and going, no, this is what Batman needs to say?
Well, there were some others, yes. I don't know if I'm free to talk about it. Don't touch that golden pussy, Robin. It could be radioactive. But we got by with it.
There were some pretty good holies. Remember some of the holies?
Yeah. How many holies did you do total, Burt? Do you remember?
I think there was about 378.
Well, I'm sorry, but we're out of time for questions because we have a big clip we want to show you. We want to close the show out with a big hunk of footage so you can see this amazing remastered footage for the Batman, the complete television series box set. So let's take a look and then we'll come back and say goodbye. November 11th, you can pre-order it right now. However, please help me thank these three amazing